Welcome to the part one series of your physiology of the kidney. So we are going to highlight very key things and we are going to run through very fast. So do pause, replay if you didn't get something. Okay, so what's the normal length of a kidney? A normal length of a kidney is anywhere between 10 to 13 centimeters. Of course, we do know that your left is slightly longer than your right one. Okay, otherwise that's a normal one. And if you have pathology, you have it much smaller than that or much larger than that. Okay, so it's useful to know the normal length of the kidney. Okay, now what you need to know is that there are three main structures of a kidney. Okay, we have this outer part that we're seeing here and we call it the cortex. Okay, the cortex is the outermost. It typically has your renal capsule, your proximal convoluted tubule, and your distal convoluted tubule of the nephron. Okay, they are located there, okay, in the cortex. Then the inner region is consisting of what looks like pyramids. Are you seeing this? This almost looks like triangular shape, what you call pyramids. This is what we call the medulla. Okay, and the medulla is the one that contains your pyramid, which surrounds your pelvis. And finally, the innermost part of the kidney is what we call the pelvis. Okay, so the pelvis is essentially, okay, maybe I should add, the medulla houses your loop of Henle and you're collecting ducts, okay? And your pelvis is literally the central cavity. That's where urine is formed after the blood has been cleansed and is deposited here. And so it continues with your urethra, which drains into your blood. So that's the pelvis. Okay, so let's run through quickly this picture here, okay? Remember, this is what you call a nephron, the functional and unit structure of the kidney, okay? So what we're having here, the blood supply comes in through what you call the afferent arteriole. Okay, which brings the blood supply to the nephron, and then it goes through a meshwork, a network of small blood vessels known as your glomerulus, okay, where there is filtration and all these other things that we'll talk about. Okay, then after it has been filtrated, it goes through your efferent arteriole, okay, to go back to the bloodstream. Okay, so that's a normal flow. This, what you're seeing like a capsule, is known as your Bowman's capsule. And then your filtrate goes on, flows through what you call the proximal convoluted tubule, okay, this tortuous area. And then when it becomes straight, we call it your proximal straight tubule, okay? And then it goes down into, now we are in the medulla here, so it thins out, okay? It typically thins out as opposed to that. So we call it the first limb, we call it the descending, okay? So it's a descending thin limb segment, okay? Then it crosses over, it becomes the ascending thin limb segment. Then it becomes broader, what we call the thick ascending limb. And then it enters this tortuous area, what you call a distal convoluted tubule. Then you have your connecting tubule. Then finally it reaches what you call your cortical collecting ducts, okay, which are continuous to your pelvis where it drains into the ureters. Okay, that should run. So remember, these structures are primarily in the cortex and these structures are primarily in your medulla. Okay, so now that we have an idea of what these things are, let's move on to the key important things on the physiology. Okay, what you need to understand is that the nephron is the basic functional unit of a kidney. Okay, it's an independent functional unit of the kidney. They are approximately actually about 1 million per kidney. Okay, and your flow typically follows from your afferent arteriole, as we have mentioned. Then it enters your glomerulocapillaries, then your efferent arterioles, then your vasa recta, which we'll discuss a bit later. Okay, and finally your renal venules. Okay, that's a normal flow that you expect in the nephron. Now, it is important, the key physiology that we need to mention for the nephron is that the diameter of the afferent arteriole is typically greater than your efferent arteriole. So it's because of this size difference that they say massive stop quickly, because the efferent is much smaller than your artery. Okay, so pressure builds up, what we call hydrostatic blood pressure. This causes what we now call your ultrafiltration. Okay, so essentially that's the physiology behind it, okay? It's your ultrafiltration that happens because of the size difference between that, and then there's pressure, okay? Now, what that pressure allows is that when you have small molecule, in renal medicine, we call it a relative molecular mass, okay? When it's less than 68,000, okay, so there you are looking at your solutes like water, glucose, amino acid, hormones, salt, urea. When they are lower than that, they are allowed to pass through to ultrafiltrate. Okay. However, larger molecules, your relative molecular mass, if it's greater than that, for example, proteins or large blood cells, they're allowed to stay back in your blood so that you don't lose that. Okay, so that's the key physiology that you need to know about the nephron. Okay, moving on to your proximal tubule. Remember, this is your proximal tubule here. Your proximal tubule, remember, we said it has two parts. Okay, so we have what you call your proximal convoluted tubule, which is your tortuous area that we have just seen there, and finally, or also known as your pars convoluta, and finally you have your proximal straight tubule. Again, we have seen that above, what you call pars recta. Okay, now what are the main functions of this proximal convoluted tubule? If you cannot see it, it's above here, your proximal convoluted tubule, and then your straight part is known as your pars recta, or what you call proximal straight tubule. Okay, so what are the functions that we expect in this? So it's important to know its structure and the function, then you'll be able to understand the physiology. Okay, salt and water particularly 80% of the water is actually reabsorbed in this area. Okay, so you have water passing from, of course, passively, then some of it, the rest by active transport, okay, through your sodium potassium ATPase. Okay, it's a receptor pump, okay, which helps you absorb that. So firstly it's passive, then active transport takes over with your sodium potassium ATPase receptor. Okay, it's about 80% that is reabsorbed in this part. Then other things that are reabsorbed is your organic solute, particularly we are talking about glucose and amino acids. Okay, these are 100%. So if you ask which area of the kidney reabsorbs 100% of all the glucose, is your proximal tubule. Okay, this is the area that reabsorbs that. However, other things that are, we have about 65% of potassium reabsorbed in this area. Urea about 50%. Okay, remember, urea is not actively reabsorbed. Its concentration in the filtrate is obviously much higher than in the blood. Okay, and finally, you have your other ones, okay, particularly phosphate, okay, phosphate and your citrate, okay, so those are around 70 to 80% reabsorbed. Okay, moving on to our loop of Henle. Remember, loop of Henle is here. We can see these three structures that it comprises of. Okay, so what are the three areas of the loop of Henle? Remember, you have your thin descending limb, okay, your thin descending limb, then your thin ascending limb, then your cortical thick ascending limb. Okay, now the key thing that you need to know about the thin descending limb is that it has way more permeability of water as opposed to your iron and the urea. Okay, and so there is way more water reabsorbed in this area as opposed to your ions and your urea. Now, as it comes back up what you call a thin ascending limb, it has zero permeability. It's actually 0%. It's impermeable to water. However, it allows your ions, particularly your potassium, your sodium, and your chlorine, to be reabsorbed. Okay, typically by secondary active transport, by your what you call your sodium potassium chloride cotransporter too. Okay, that's the receptor. But because of this gradient, it forms a gradient, it also promotes reabsorption of the other solutes such as magnesium and calcium. Okay, so that's useful to know. And finally, we have your cortical thick ascending limb. Okay, your cortical thick ascending limb, the main function is simply to drain urine into your distal convoluted tubule, because that's where it's connected to. Okay, now I want to highlight here a common misnomer. Okay, we typically think the thin and thick means the actual lumen, but it has nothing to do with the size of the actual lumen, but it has to do with the size of the epithelial cells. Okay, so the size of the epithelial cells. Remember, The tissue types of the loop of Henle is typically simple squamous epithelium. Okay, so if the size of the cells are thin, we call it thin, as we're seeing it here, then your thick is typically your cortical thick ascending limb. Okay, moving on to the blood supply of the loop of Henle. Remember, if you go to understand the loop of Henle, is it like that? It's typically surrounded by multiple, what you call a surrounding loop of network of capillaries surrounding the loop of Henle, okay? Which have a characteristic, what you call a hairpin structure, okay? And this, ladies and gentlemen, this loop of a network of capillaries is known as your vasa recta. So it's very useful for reabsorbing, especially your solutes and water back into the blood. Okay, that's what we call the blood supply to mainly the loop of Henle. Okay, now what is the important physiology that you need to know? Remember, we're just covering key things. Okay, now here you have to listen very carefully. The descending limb, remember, this is the descending limb, it receives about 300 milliosmol fluid from your proximal convoluted tubule. Of course, it's your proximal convoluted tubule that gives. Now, the loop of Henle, the work of the loop of Henle actually is to make the concentration of your interstitial tissue, which is in the medulla, in your lumen, to become hypertonic. Okay? So to becoming hypertonic, which means there is greater solute concentration to the filtrate. Remember, we typically take out water, right, initially. Okay, so it becomes mainly hypertonic. Okay, so so by actively transporting, of course, you have your chloride ions out of the filtrate into the surrounding. Then now your 300 milliosmol fluid from the loop loses water to the higher concentration outside of the loop, and thus increases the tonicity, which is just what we said. Now this brings about where in physiology we say by the time you reach the end here, remember this limb is impermeable to water, this is very permeable to water. By the time you reach here, the fluid in the lumen has the lowest water potential. Okay, that's very useful to know. Okay, then the ascending limb of the loop of Henle, remember water is not reabsorbed, the ions are readily reabsorbed. The ions leave the lumen via your, of course, your sodium potassium chloride symporter. And even the sodium H antipotter, the concentration becomes more and more hypotonic. Okay, because remember, solute is starting to leave until it reaches about 100 to 150 milliosmol per liter. Okay, that's why now we say the ascending limb is called the diluting segment of the nephron because of its ability to dilute the fluid in the loop. You understand? Because you are losing a lot of solute back into the blood, and so it becomes more hypotonic. All right, now that we understand that, I just want to quickly highlight this terminology. You hear it a lot in the renal medicine. So the countercurrent multiplier system is basically what we're saying here, because we have talked about the filtrate flows in the opposite direction in the two limbs. So you have your descending limb, remember, your solute are moving there, okay, they are moving into the lumen. However, you have the opposite paradoxical thing in your ascending limb, which you have your solute moving outside. So that opposite direction in the two limbs, we call it the countercurrent multiplier system. Okay, I hope that makes some sense. Okay, moving on to your distal convoluted tubule. Okay, if you don't remember, we go back to our image. We've talked about these three parts of the loop of Henle. Then we have your distal convoluted tubule, which is the tortuous part of the distal part here. Okay, what are we supposed to know? Number one, you're supposed to know the function, okay? The key function of the distal convoluted tubule, okay? Just know that it's responsible mainly to regulate particularly potassium, your sodium, calcium, and most importantly, pH. Okay, this is the area where this, especially calcium, okay, never forget calcium, never forget pH, okay, especially these two, this is the area where they are mainly regulated. Now, what is the key physiology that we need to know in this area? Okay, remember the walls of the distal convoluted tubule are permeable to water only in presence of ADH, okay, antidiuretic hormone. Otherwise, they are impermeable to water. That's very important to know. If it's permeable to water, of course, water exits the filtrate into your bloodstream. And then, of course, you'll go into less diuresis, okay? If it's not permeable, a hypotonic filtrate enters your collecting ducts, okay? In the presence of ADHD, water moves out into the bloodstream, and so you reduce the incidence of diuresis. All right, otherwise, it's completely impermeable to water in the absence of antidiuretic hormone. Okay, now, there is a common, I just want to highlight something quickly. Perhaps you are a bit unsure of the, because we kept using the word secretion and reabsorption. Always remember, secretion, okay, we are assuming this is a lumen. These are the blood capillaries that surround the lumen, okay? Tubular secretion is the transfer of material from your peritubular capillaries, which is your blood vessels that surround it, okay, into the renal tubular lumen, okay, to which eventually goes to form your urine, okay? And the truth is opposite for renal absorption, is from the lumen to the peritubular capillaries, okay? I just wanted to highlight that important one, okay? Now, how does the distal convoluted tubule manage pH regulation? It's very, very simple. Remember, bicarb is essentially more alkaline, okay? So if you have a lot of your bicarbonate in your blood, your pH naturally rises. If you have protons in the blood, it becomes more acidic. So by playing around with secretion and reabsorption, you can regulate, okay? So for example, if in the blood it's very acidic, all you have to do is to secrete more of the H plus into the lumen, and you reabsorb more of bicarb. Then you have trying to balance out your pH. So that's how it works, okay? Please look up something interesting, your thiazide, how they causes your hypocalcemia in the distal convoluted tubule, because thiazides are known to cause hypocalcemia. It's very interesting how they work on the distal convoluted tubule to cause hypocalcemia. All right, then we move on to the last part of the structure that we are going to describe, is your collecting ducts. Again, we go back quickly to our diagram. We can see this part is your collecting ducts, and remember, the majority of the collecting ducts is in the medulla. Okay, now what key points do we need to know on collecting ducts? Okay, now what you need to understand is that just like the distal convoluted tubule, remember we talked about the distal convoluted tubule, it's only permeable to water if in the presence of ADHD. It's the same here. Okay, collecting ducts are only permeable to water if there is a presence of ADH, okay? Otherwise, it's impermeable to water, okay? So, remember, ADH is present. Remember, if you have ADH because of the RAS system, if the ADH is, for example, the patient is very hypovolemic, the body responds, it produces antidiuretic hormone because you do not want to lose fluid, okay? It allows the aquaporins, remember the aquaporins are essentially the areas of fissures, né? To allow reabsorption of the water back into the bloodstream, to conserve it, okay? So in the presence of ADH, your aquaporin is present, sorry, your aquaporins allow for the reabsorption of this water, thereby inhibiting diuresis, okay? In the absence of antidiuretic hormone, water in the renal filtrate is left alone, promoting diuresis, okay? And finally, always know that the system accounts, the collecting ducts do play a role in sodium reabsorption. For about 4 to 5% of the amount of sodium is reabsorbed actually in the collecting ducts. That concludes the end of the part 1 of the renal physiology.